Good afternoon, folks. As my brothers have been sharing with you, we want to continue talking about the glory of God. Jesus Christ, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the Savior of mankind, the one who created us, the one who sustains us, the one who has made a way for us to be forgiven of our sins. And we need that desperately, people, because even if you don't recognize it, we desperately all need to be saved from the wrath of God. Now, last night downtown, a lady assured me there was no such thing as the wrath of God. She even claimed to have read the Bible from cover to cover and still insisted that God did not have a wrath. But friends, do not be deceived. I assure you there is a wrath of God. I'll give you an example, a couple of examples maybe. Back in Noah's day, you remember in Bible school and Sunday school, you heard the story of Noah and the ark, right? Where God looked down, he saw that the wickedness of man's heart was continually wicked. That's a loose paraphrase. But there was wickedness all over the face of the earth. Man's heart was black with wickedness and conjured up all sorts of evil. And so God looked down and it grieved him, and he was sorry, the Bible says, that he had made man. Can you believe that God, who created us, who created man in his own image, the crowning glory of his creation, that it would repent God and make him wish he had never created man? Can you imagine being that evil? Well, friends, in our natural state, we're all that evil. But to show you that there is a wrath of God, God saw that the wickedness was massive on planet Earth. And so he decided to destroy every living creature on Earth with a flood. And so he commissioned Noah. He found Noah and commissioned him to build an ark. And you know how the story goes? Noah, or God, brought animals on the ark to preserve them. He brought Noah and his wife, his three sons, and their wives on the ark. And then it says that God shut the door. And then it began to rain on Earth. And the waters broke up from the deep and came up from under the ground. And the water was over all the face of the earth. And every living man and woman and child perished and died. Now, if you can read that story, that historical account, and come to the conclusion that God does not have a wrath, you're not paying attention. And you have a comprehension problem. So, friends, I assure you, God has a wrath. Yes, God is love. God is long-suffering. God is patient. God is kind. If he wasn't any of that, none of us would be alive right now. He would have done killing all of us. But he is kind, loving, and patient. But friends, do not be deceived. He also has a wrath. And he pours his wrath out on the wicked. And friends, if you die in your sins, you are going to be receive this wrath of God. And that's why we come here with you, is because we don't want you to receive the wrath of God. We don't want you to die in your sin and go to a lake of fire forever and ever and ever. We want you to be forgiven and have eternal life. And that's why we're here. But friends, the good news is good news because it's bad news. You see, the reason we're all in our sin is because way back in the Garden of Eden, when God made Adam and Eve, he put them there. And he said, of every tree of the Garden of Eden you can freely eat, except for the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And as human beings go, they took and they ate of the fruit. And this, the scripture says, is where sin entered into the world. And because you and I are all descendants of Adam and Eve, guess what? We're all born, as King David said, into sin. We're all born with a sin nature, and that, folks, is why we sin. That's why sin naturally flows from us. Some of us, even more so than others, it seems, some of us it flows like a fire hydrant from us because it's our very nature, and we give into that nature. And so that sin is what separates us from God. That sin is our problem, because that sin has to be atoned for. That sin has to be paid for, that debt. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. And it says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All. That means every last one of us have this sin debt that we bear upon ourselves that we can do nothing to get rid of. We can't do enough good to atone for our sin. We can't give enough money to charity. We can't do anything to get rid of our sin debt. And you say, well, if that's the case, preacher, we're in big trouble. Yes, we are. We are in big trouble. That's why we're here to beg you and plead you to understand that without Christ, you're in big trouble. This life is but a vapor. It's only here for a short time and then it's gone. You may have 50 years, 100 years, but you may not have tomorrow. We don't know. But folks, outside of Christ, you have big trouble. Your life is in peril. Your eternal destiny is in peril. Even though this life is a vapor and very short, eternity lasts forever, something that we can't even really comprehend. So I beg you to think about the things of eternity. And see, God didn't leave us in this state of sin and leave us with no hope, with no way out. That's why Jesus Christ came. That's why we come and we lift up the name of Christ. We give him all praise and glory because he came. God himself took on humanity and walked planet Earth, being tempted in all ways you and I are, yet he never sinned. This is your creator. This is the one who knit you together in your mother's womb. This is the one who allows you to breathe his air right now. This one came while you're yet his enemy and willingly sacrificed himself on the cross, where he took the wrath of God that we deserve. You see, Jesus came, lived a perfect, sinless life, and laid his life down willingly, was beaten terribly, was hung on a cross where he died between two criminals. He was taken down, he was buried in a borrowed tomb. And as my friend said just a minute ago, on that third day, he rose from the dead. Jesus got up out of the grave, defeating death and proving that he was in fact God. And he did that for a specific reason. He did that to save sinners like you and like me. But it's not automatic. It's not just everybody goes to heaven kind of thing. Because Jesus came when he walked planet Earth and he came preaching something. If you read in Mark, you'll see that Mark begins his gospel by saying, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So Mark starts out by declaring, this is the Son of God, or this is the Messiah. This is the one who has been prophesied that would come to take away the sins of the world. And he goes back and he proves this. He goes back 400 years to the prophet Malachi, and he tells us, he says, behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare the way before you. This is from Malachi, 400 years before Jesus was born. And then he goes back another 400 years to 800 years earlier to Isaiah, who says, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. They were both prophesying of one called John the Baptist, whom you may have heard of. And then Mark shows us when John the Baptist entered the scene. He goes on and he says, John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Then all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him and were all baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Now John, if you think we're weirdos and we look weird, you should have seen John. John the Baptist was out in the wilderness and listened to the description of him. It says, now John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist. And he ate locusts and wild honey. So this John the Baptist, this weirdo, was out in the wilderness preaching that people should be baptized for the remission of sin. And then he says, there comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loose. I indeed baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. So see, John the Baptist now is prophesying that Jesus is coming. This Messiah is coming. So we have these four witnesses so far. We have Mark himself. We have Malachi. We have Isaiah. We have John the Baptist. And then listen to what happens. It came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And immediately, coming up from the water, he saw the heavens parting and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. Then a voice came from heaven, and said, "You are my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased." So see, here we have two more witnesses, the other two persons of the Godhead. The Holy Spirit descended on Jesus, and God the Father declared, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And immediately Jesus was driven out into the wilderness where he was tempted. And now we have a very strange witness. Verse 12 says, "Immediately the Spirit drove him into the wilderness, and he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by who? By Satan. And was with the wild beast, and the angels ministered to him." And Satan came, you can read in other Gospels, and he tempted him in ways like this. He says, "If you are the Son of God." So see, even Satan testified to the fact that Jesus is, in fact, the Son of God, the Messiah that had been prophesied in years past. And after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. And he was saying, now think about who's saying this. This is not John the Baptist. This is not one of the apostles. This is Jesus, God himself, comes preaching and saying this. Now, I beg you, when God, your creator, your sustainer, says something, it's better for you to open your ears and hear what he says. These are not my words. These are not Mark's words. These are the words of Christ himself. But he came preaching this. He said, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." You can read that on that sign my brother has right there. The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And that's what Jesus came preaching. So what does he mean when he says all this? What does it mean when he says the time is fulfilled? Well, let's go back to these prophets who prophesied about the coming of John the Baptist, who prophesied about the coming of this Savior, the Son of God. And Jesus is saying that time, people, is fulfilled because here I am. Jesus is declaring that he is the Messiah, the Son of God, the one that was to come. And then he says the kingdom of God is at hand. Why does he say that? He says that because he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. So all this prophecy from the Old Testament is being fulfilled at this very moment in Christ, who has come, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And when he comes, he begins preaching and he says this. He doesn't come preaching and saying, "Oh, I love you like you are, you're good." He comes preaching and he says, "Repent. Repent and believe in the gospel." That's what God himself commands you to do. That's what the first thing out of God's mouth on planet Earth when he began his ministry, Jesus himself, is that you should repent. So why is that so offensive, that little word repent? A lot of times you never even hear that in our churches. Why not? Because we don't want to hurt any feelings. Because we don't want to make anybody angry. But friends, let me tell you, if you're outside of Christ in your sin, the gospel is going to offend you. It's natural that it will, because our very nature makes us want to be our own little God, makes us want to rule our own lives and do our own thing. So when you get offended at the preaching of the gospel, you can get mad at me if you want, that's fine. But you're really getting mad at God, the one who proclaimed that you are to repent. And repent is a word, it's pretty simple. The root word means to change your mind. To change your mind. And what happens when you have this change of mind? You have a change of action. You turn from your sin and you repent and you turn to Christ and turn from your sin. He can save even you, young man, even though you mock the preaching of his word. He can save your soul today. I pray that he will. So you need to repent, turn from sin. And then Jesus says, believe in the gospel. Believe in the gospel. What is the gospel? You ask people, you don't have to go to hell, sir. I don't want you to go there. That's why I'm here. I want you to go to heaven and have eternal life. But the gospel, what is the gospel? The gospel, if you ask people, you'll get many varying answers, many different answers. But the simple gospel is this. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel, that Jesus, God himself, came to planet Earth, took on humanity. He was fully God, fully man. He didn't lose his divinity, but he added to it humanity. And he walked planet Earth just like you and I. He was tempted in all ways just like you and I are.
but he didn't sin. Unlike you and I, he never sinned. He never broke God's law. And in spite of that, this Jesus was arrested. He was beaten beyond recognition, probably. You couldn't hardly recognize him. His back was ripped to shreds. He was nailed to a Roman cross, where he died a horrific death, hung between two criminals, and he was taken down. He was buried in a borrowed tomb, fulfilling more prophecy. But on that third day, the tomb was empty. There was no one there because Jesus had risen from the dead, has defeated death, and proved that he was God. And you say, well, maybe you're like his enemies. They made up stories and said, well, his disciples must have stolen his body. That couldn't have happened. You know why? If you read the historical account, you'll see that when they put him in the tomb, they rolled a big stone over it. They sealed the tomb and even put a guard on it. So there's no way that his body could have been stolen. Absolutely no way. So Jesus, friends, he is risen today. He rose from the dead, defeating death, after he had taken the punishment we deserve upon himself on this cross. He sacrificed himself willingly. He says that no one takes my life, I lay it down. And he did this willingly so that sinners like you and I could have eternal life. That's how loving and kind and gracious this God is. But don't presume upon his patience. Don't presume upon his kindness. Don't presume on his love that he is going to wink at your sin forever. God bless you, ma'am. Hope you repent and trust the Christ. So don't presume on his love. So he even makes you walk around on his earth and mock him and blaspheme, and still lets you live. And most people take that to mean that he's okay and that you're okay. But no, you're not. See, God is patient. He is kind, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to the knowledge of the truth. That's why he allows you to go on planet Earth and do wickedness, because he is kind and patient. So today, folks, I beg you to turn from your sin and turn to Christ and put your faith and your trust in him and him alone. But don't presume that you're going to make it on your own merit, because you will not. Again, Paul tells us in Ephesians, he says, you're saved by grace through faith, not of works, so you have nothing to boast about. What does that mean? You're saved by grace. What grace? The grace of God. The grace of God. See, God has mercy. Mercy is God not giving us what we deserve. But grace is God giving us what we don't deserve. So when he's merciful to us, he's not killing us right now for sin. And when he shows his grace to us, he gives us things we don't deserve. One of those being eternal life through faith in Christ. Not through your own merits. Not through your own goodness. If you plan on going and standing before God when you die, as we all will, and stand there on your own in your pride, saying, I believe I'm going to convince God that I'm good enough to come into his kingdom, you're going to be sadly mistaken when you hear these words, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. And folks, we don't want that for you. We want you to be redeemed to your Creator. Don't bow to me and mock me. It's not me. You have to stand before God and be judged by him. So please repent and put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. How you doing?
Hi. My faith and trust is in Jesus.
Amen. God bless. You have a good day. Enjoy the game, okay? So, folks, today we beg you and plead with you to turn from sin and turn to Christ. And let me be clear that I'm not standing here saying that everyone out here is not in Christ. I know there's brothers and sisters out here. There's other believers. I thank God for you. I encourage you to share this message with others. But, folks, the Bible says that broad is the path that leads to destruction, and narrow is the way that leads to righteousness, and few there be that find it. So more than likely on this bridge, as we look at all these thousands of people, more than likely more of these people are going to end up in hell than in heaven. That's a sad truth. That's a sad truth. But folks, you don't have to go to hell. You don't have to do it. All you have to do is bow your knee to Christ. Put your faith and trust in him and him alone. And when you do that, the Bible tells us that what Jesus did on the cross, when he took the wrath of God upon himself, that that is counted as payment for your sin debt. He took that wrath you deserve and wiped your sin debt clean. And on top of that, he gives you his very own righteousness so that when you stand before him in judgment, he sees you in right standing with God, not as the wicked sinner you were born as. That's what we call the great exchange. So folks, today, turn from the sin, turn to Christ, and put your faith and your trust in him and him alone. You see, the problem is this. We talked about our sin problem that separates us from God. We talked about the way God has made a way for us to be forgiven of that sin and be redeemed to our Creator. What about those that don't believe either way? Well, see, there's no such thing. There's two types of people on planet Earth, two basic types of people. There are those in Christ, and there are those who are dead in their sin. There's two options for eternity. There's bow the knee, repent, and trust Christ, and have eternal life, be redeemed to your Creator, and be with him in heaven forever, or refuse the offer, continue living life your way, doing your thing, die in your sin, and end up in the lake of fire paying your own sin debt. You see, if you're against Christ, if you're out of Christ, the biggest thing against you is the fact that God is good. You think God's goodness goes to the extent of accepting sin. But it does not because God is good. He will judge sin. If he didn't judge sin, he would not be good. He would be wicked. He would be corrupt. But he is good. So see, God will have payment for sin. God will take payment for sin. If you bow the knee and put your faith in Christ, Jesus' suffering and sacrifice on the cross is counted as payment. It covers your sin. It washes it away, never to be spoken of again. But if you refuse that and you die in your sin, you're going to end up here. You see, Jesus is, as I spoke earlier, our Creator. Jesus is our Redeemer. He's the one that made the way for us to be redeemed to God. But he is also the Judge. If you die in your sin, this is what you have to look forward to. It says, then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death, and anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So there it is, folks. If you insist on thinking you can get to God and get there on your own merit, on your own goodness, you're free to do that. You can try that. But when you die and you stand before God, he's going to open these record books that record even your very thoughts, and all your sin is going to be laid bare. And there's no atonement for your sin because you refuse the only Savior of the world. And you're going to be found guilty. So if you want to be judged by your works, you're free to do so, but it's not going to end well for you. You're going to hear the awful words, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you. So folks, do not depend on yourself to redeem yourself to God. It can't work. It won't happen. The Bible says even our righteous deeds are like filthy rags. But folks, friends, if you will bow the knee, if you will put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, here's what you have to look forward to. He says, then he who sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give of the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. And we'll go to this place called heaven. And the Bible says that God will wipe away every tear. There'll be no more sorrow. There'll be no more pain. There'll be no more death. Everything will be made right. Paradise restored, if you will. So there it is, folks. You can refuse to follow Jesus Christ, refuse to trust him and believe in the gospel, and end up in the lake of fire where there's weeping, gnashing of teeth, where the soul never dies and the fire is never quenched, to suffer for eternity upon eternity to pay your sin debt. Or you can simply bow the knee to Christ, put your faith in him, believe the gospel, and be redeemed to your Creator and have eternal life with him. And have peace. Be at peace with God, where there's no more tears, no more sorrow, no more suffering, no more pain, no more death. So I beg you today, as you go in here and have a good time at this game, that you think about eternal matters. Think about eternal things. This life is fleeting. Eternity lasts forever. So please today, repent and trust the Lord Jesus Christ.